Welcome to This Week in Perspective, the first after the program has been off the air for almost 2 years, with me, Adam Simbe. After the last program went on the air on the 27th of February 2014, today is a lot has passed under the bridge, and the country went through the general election, general and presidential election on the 25th of October, with all its surprises, thus ushering in the fifth phase administration of President John Pombe Magufuli, the former Minister for Works, in the fourth administration. And of course, the budget 2016-2019, which is almost 29 Tanzania, billion, trillion Tanzania shillings, I mean his first budget. To discuss this political development in the country with me are, on the left, Dr. Buhela Lunagero, who is a social and economic analyst, but former executive director of the Economic and Social Foundation. Professor Prosper Ngoi from University, Mzumbe University, but an economist and a regular participant in the previous program, as well as Dr. Nagel. On the right, Dr. Dina Mbaga, former University of Dar es Salaam, but social researcher as well, and an activist. Last but not least, Professor Maxim Muya from University of Dar es Salaam, Department of Political Science and Public Administration, also regular participants in the previous programs. So, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to This Week in Perspective once again.
Thank you.
I hope we'll do justice to this topic for the first time after being absent from the airwaves already of Tanzania, of TBC, for 2 years. Let's start with the very first question, and that will be, as I said, so much has been said for and against the fifth phase administration. In your view, have Tanzanians accepted this administration, and are they genuinely and honestly behind President Magufuli's no-nonsense leadership?
Okay, I think maybe just to open up the debate.
Yes.
I thought it's better to have a historical perspective on where we came from and what really drives this excitement, as you call it.
Yes.
As far back, actually, as 2000, when the Vision 20, the document for Vision 2025 was being prepared, because there was a team of people who went around getting views of people on what the Tanzania we want.
Yes.
Among the key areas which they had wanted to have a big change, actually, was on the style of governance, fighting corruption, bureaucracy, and a culture of laissez-faire among Tanzanians. So come President Kikwete, one of the excitement which they had, actually, when President Kikwete came in, was that he had promised to bring a fast change, kasi mpya, as it was called. Mm-hmm. And so they had that hope that things will move to maybe supersonic speed. But I think JK's government, his style was slightly different. He believed, in my view, in trying to prepare an institutional framework. And that's why you could see, actually, during the 10 years, he tried a lot to do reforms of the judiciary, the police force, PCCB, Tukukuru, Tumeongozi.
Okay.
And I think he believed that for it to be sustainable, you must have strong institutions to oversee.
Yeah.
But to oversee the transformation needed. But I think he also overlooked the fact that when you have already a degenerated social order, the leader at the top needed to do some extra sacrifice in terms of enforcing and taking some extra action which is needed extrajudicial decisiveness.
Yeah.
And I think that was his undoing, the way I see it.
Okay.
And that's why I think the last general election, there was a lot of excitement between the two candidates, because both of them were promising to be decisive and firm in dealing with the issues of governance.
Okay.
And that's why I think everybody is excited with his style, President Magufuli's style, that he's trying to address what they had longed for the last 20 years.
Okay.
So we are like 20 years late in terms of actually dealing with the issues which President Magufuli is doing right now.
Okay.
That's my opening remark, I could say.
All right. Professor Muya, the same question if you would like to address, maybe different, but let's hear from your point of view.
Well, my point of view is usually, and many, many circumstances, when anything comes into the table at the beginning, people are excited about it.
Yes.
They think it is a solution, it is a panacea to all the challenges they previously faced. And this is what I saw when the new administration came to office. They looked, as our companion told you, at the previous company, if you want to call it that way, and said, okay, we now have possibilities for change. And they outlined those areas. Maybe we're just shy to specify some of the areas which they were very, very conscious about to see go. And in that regard, I would like to caution the people, and I cautioned my students even from the beginning.
Mm-hmm. That this is just political science.
They're just euphoric, because there are elements and strategies and actions for fulfilling whatever you want to have claimed as the solution to the problems which you previously owned. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Professor Ngoi.
Yeah, thank you. I think I would agree that some have accepted the administration,
yes.
But I think there is a bigger debate here. There are those who would accept in the public and would not accept in the hiding, so to say. So I think the question of whether they've accepted it genuinely, I think it's an issue here. There are those who would accept because, you know, that's how people have to do it in public, but really deep inside themselves, they wish things were different. But also within accepting, I think there are those who are accepting because they understand it's a good thing in the long run. They know that there are negative consequences on the way.
Yes.
There are sacrifices to be made. There are those who would accept, really out of fear, accepting and doing exactly the way he wants. Not necessarily because they believe so, but because of fear.
Why would you think that they wouldn't accept it seriously, but
with
a bit of reservation. Why?
Yeah, I said there are negative consequences, unintended negative consequences in all these kind of things. As Dr. Lugo said, people were used to laissez faire situation, you know,
yes.
Business as usual. Yes. Now with the business unusual way of doing things,
there are
people who will be suffering. There are people who have to really work harder than they are used to. So they might feel really forced to accept.
Yes.
Although it is done, it's a good thing.
Yes.
But really, that's not the way they were used to. And so if they had their own way, maybe they would not have accepted to move with the change.
In terms of proportion, do you think there's a larger proportion of the populace that would behave the way you were describing? I mean,
I won't give figures without further research. but I think you know, it's something that is still unfolding really with time.
Yes.
I would say maybe when the new administration began, I think there was a lot of general acceptance that yes, this is what we've been missing, this is how things should be going. But then the way we are moving,
yes.
You know, the journey keeps on going.
Yes.
We see there are some groups who would say that's okay. There are some groups who say, no, this is too much. There are some groups who say, no, it would have been done a little bit different.
Maybe so because they are directly affected?
Partly, I would say.
Some of the decisions and the actions?
Yeah, of course. Mm-hmm. But so I would say it's less than a year, so it is still unfolding story.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
I would, you know, well back in on the 3rd of January 2015,
yes.
I wrote in my column, The Citizen,
yes.
that when new administration comes in, when new regime comes in, always for there is what we call wait and see. You know, yes. We are not sure. For example, when I wrote this in January, that is almost 10 months before the election, we aren't sure which regime will come in, whether it will be a CCM regime or opposition. And now, if it was opposition, we aren't sure who within the opposition. And now that we knew it's CCM, we are not sure who within CCM. Now we know who within CCM has become the president. So to me, I think if people were to be very frank, I think that the wait and see is still there. There are a lot of things that are yet unfolding. So in terms of predictability of policies, and I think as we move along, it is still really, things are still emerging. And it might be too early to classify now that this is the person that is saying yes, because I think it is really dynamic.
Okay. Dr. Mbaga, Dino.
Thank you very much. I think I'll take from what Ngo just said, the wait and see. I mean, when it comes to development, let me first say that the first 2 months, so to say, everybody was clapping for a change. As the three of my colleagues have said, politicians normally like to give people what they would like to hear. Let me take you back to President Kaunda when he came into, this is many years ago, when he came to power. He promised Zambians that they will eat egg and bacon for breakfast. The Zambians are still looking for egg and breakfast today. Now, what do you say when people are crying or they are talking about corruption, about this and that service not being available? Education has gone way down what people had expected. Health facilities are not there. And most of all, the current president is so much talking about the common person. So if you want to win the heart of a common person, what do you do? You have to talk about the common person. But again, one professor one time gave a lecture. And the students asked a question. One student, very bright student, asked a question. But professor, how does this work in reality? So what we are seeing now is, well, we so well said it, we are still saying, what is it that is going to happen in reality? How will the common man really, how is his life going to be improved? How is education, which is free, and it's not a new thing, because 1967, if I'm right, in the 1960s, presidents of Africa met in Addis Ababa and proclaimed free education for every country. So 1977, in this country, we had universal primary education. You see, so it's kind of mixed. Of course, he's coming up with his new way of governance, which I would call, management by walking, because he gives us surprises every day. He walks into this, and it's because he's really trying hard to see, to rectify the situation. But the question is, do we all understand the vision? Uh-huh. What vision? Where are we heading to? We are saying we are heading for industrialization, whatever we call it, but does everybody, especially the common man who is trying to be, liberated or whatever, do we understand the philosophy? Do we understand the road which we are going to follow?
But Dr. Mbaga, do you think it is time now for the ordinary, for the common man to start understanding the way things are being done, when they want to see now is that their problems, their current problems, the day-to-day problems are being addressed, which is, as you said, in the background of the Lugero, in the past, these things were not addressed.
Oh, if we say in the past things were not addressed, I don't quite agree. In words, again, in words, people were given hope for the best. Like when he says, Arimpia, Kasimpia, we are all thinking of marching and moving forward. So today it's like we are still talking of the same thing, but in a different language. But at the same time, we have to be fair that 5 months...
7 months now.
Seven months to really give a justice assessment, I think it's too early. However, it's the direction which Joe shows us whether we are in the right step or not. So in terms of intentions, he has good intentions.
Okay.
We are going back, I think, to Nyereism, yeah, where everybody should work, everybody should be responsible. But let me point out one thing. Change is not something which comes overnight. We have to start with changing people's attitudes. As somebody said among my colleagues, that business as usual. People were used to going out having tea for about 2 hours and then coming back and working. So we are talking of change of attitude. Mm. We are talking of changing people's perception. What kind of methodology is he using to do all this? So it's not really clear.
He admits that it's
not an easy, it's not an easy task to change people's attitude and to let them believe in that what you're saying really will take us there. It's like we are coming from Egypt going to the promised land. So we are waiting to see going into that promise.
What I wanted to say is that in my view, President Magufuli has one added advantage. His historical background testifies that he is a man of consistency and of high stamina, of following up whatever he wants to do. That's the evidence, actually. For the past 20 years, he has been in cabinet. So that's a positive part of it. Now, I think for it really to be sustainable, qualified, I think that's what I was saying. The administration needs now to build in institutional sustainability of following up his style of administration, so that it filters, it sinks in to the lowest level of organizational structure, both in government and in private sector. So that we people don't do things in reaction or day to day reaction. It should be like a new style, a new way of being, way of life for Tanzanians. And I think if we succeed in doing that,
yes,
and in my view, to among the key three institutions,
yes,
which can really succeed to sustain that momentum which has started.
Yes.
If we can make sure that the judiciary, the police force, the institutions which oversee issues of corruption, meaning Takukuru, PPCB, and the office which oversees leadership code of conduct,
yes,
make sure that, and of course the controller and the auditor general. And then on one hand, if we also strengthen our parliament to make sure that it helps the government to make sure that the reports from the controller and auditor general are followed to the end, to me, that will be actually a plus. It will leave a living legacy for Tanzanians. Rather than continue with a style where he's like single-handedly doing everything himself, and I think that's the danger if he continues that style. But if I think he knows about it, and that's why the other day he promised the judiciary that I'm going to give you more money so that you can clear the cases on time. I think he has promised the police force also make sure that the reforms which the previous face of government had started in terms of reforming the police force continues. Make sure they have good housing, they are well paid, so that there's less temptation to take a bribe. And of course, strengthen all the other organs. I think because that's where the biggest weakness of Tanzanian system.
Yeah.
Even the private sector, when they, if you talk to them, if you read the reports on Tanzanian ranking in terms of business investment,
yeah,
it's the uncertainty in terms of decision making, the bureaucracy, the way it takes long. Yesterday, for example, at Mkuranga, there's that factory which was closed by Nemki.
Yes.
That Chinese was saying, but sir, I've been trying for the past 2 years to get that paper I've used a lot of urgents to come. I'm told, wait tomorrow. Meanwhile, you had to start doing something.
Doing business as usual.
I think the issue of bureaucracy, for example, making sure that every institution plays its part, that will be really a big plus for
the country. Okay. Professor Muya, let me start off with you. Do you think the President Magufuli's transformational administration, and of course we call it a reconstruction, will be achieved? Because this is more or less like it's trying to transform the way we do things, the way the public sector does things, the way the private sector, and if we can manage to transform our mental state of mind, as Donna says, it would be a good thing. But do you think we will be able to achieve this?
It's doubtful. It's very doubtful whether they can manage it. And the basic reason is, first, we do have a group of persons in society, as you're saying, and these persons of society have got their own ideals which they want to attain. And they challenge the administration in order to attain what they wanted to attain. And this is what we saw in other institutions before, other presidential games before, and it includes now as well. Because the Tanzanian citizens, they are mere personnel who would like to achieve this and that and that. But then the decision to achieve that is in the hands of those in power. Jokingly, some of our colleagues were saying, you know, when the president walked from the State House
to the Minister of Finance,
he didn't have money. There was no option for him. He had to do that. He didn't have
check
money.
Check whether there is money.
Yeah. Not to check, but to make sure, hey, guys, let me have the money. Yes. I am president now. Yes. And then symbolically, quite a number of people thought that, you know, here is a human being's person, president.
Yes.
It's not. He was challenged. And he couldn't have a car. He couldn't take a car. He would have been seen as a strange person. The Ikulu is right there, and the treasury next door.
Yeah. You take a car?
No way. So you must bring a sense of sympathy. And of course, along the same line, you must go to Muhimbili. So these are human considerations which are put in terms of a project, but which actually, when it comes to operational trends, it doesn't happen that way.
Yeah, thank you. I agree with the professor that for this really transformation to be a success, really, as the professor said, it's a change from within. It's there should be change of attitude. In Latin, I studied some Latin. It's also called metanoia, total change of systems, change of structures, and it should not really be based on fear, because if people now start to do the way things, because they are afraid of the president, the minister becomes afraid of the president, the PS becomes afraid of the minister, the director becomes afraid of the PS, regional commissioner. So we should not really be doing things to please the president, to please the minister, to please my vice chancellor, etc. We should be doing things because those are correct things to do. I think when we reach that stage,
yes,
and I don't see we are there yet, when we are ready that say we are in the hiding, nobody sees us, yet we do correct things. We know that, yes, it's 4 o'clock, it's time for going home, but I should not go because I've not accomplished the work. When I know that, yes, it is 8 and I have to be in workplace because I have to be there, not because I'm going to be supervised, not because
I'm going to be locked out.
Not because somebody's going, yeah, that's why we'll come to that. So I think, it takes more than the micromanaging part of the thing, as we're saying, for really this change to be achieved.
How long will it take?
Well, I don't know. And actually, I wanted to come to this because I said 50 plus years after independence, that people have to work because they are afraid of the president, afraid of the minister, afraid of the director, afraid of the vice chancellor. In my context, I think it's very unfortunate. You know. It's very unfortunate. So I think, I don't know how long, I'm not a human behavior person, but I don't know how long it takes for people to change in real sense. We had the big results now, and we discussed it here once.
Yes.
We are saying, you know, things will not just happen because now you are forcing people to deliver, to perform, and all that. If there is no change from within,
yes,
it will take quite a long time.
no change from within, then, Dinah, do you think we'll be able to move forward?
Yeah. A president is like, he is the head. And really, he can't do it himself. The question is, how much are the people, like ministers, as you say, regional commissioners, or even head of a section in a ministry, how many of them understand what the president is really? I mean, what I'm trying to say is, a human being would like to have clear guidelines, but there should also be a forum whereby things are made clear. Up to now, I don't think there has been, I'm not talking about seminar elekezi, although we can't really avoid them. But at least when we, those years with Education for Self-Reliance, with Ujamaa, with all these things, there were, at least we knew which direction to do. If it's Education for Self-Reliance, people went farming and this kind of thing. But today, and as again, I would like to say it's too early. I'm not criticizing, but I'm just concerned with the way we are running. Of course, we want to run. This is, again, the late Mwalimu Nyerere's philosophy, running when others are walking.
In the moon.
I can understand the president's way, I can say way of thinking, vision, that he would like to see things move fast. But you can't move fast. For example, right now it's like there's a competition of how many majipus one is going to tumbua. Like, we have issues, like I can say, in education, because that is my line of work. There's so much which needs to be done in education. So I would have expected that minister, and I'm not criticizing, but it's a concern, to start thinking of how to consolidate education instead of thinking how to dismantle institutions. You know? I mean, we are fast to see where to...
Should we slow down then? Should we slow down?
No, I'm saying let each ministry now sit down and plan of how they want us to reach the goal which the president was. Like, if you say want industries, then the Minister of Education, for example, should think of VETA and all this. How do we prepare them for that? In other words, there are practical issues to be done instead of looking at how many people we should fire. Okay? So I'm talking of guidelines, but I think the... And I'm not an advisor to the president, but there needs to be a forum with all the ministers. I don't know, maybe one has been there because I'm very far from that angle, whereby each ministry should now chart out, these are the goals. We want fast development. How do we reach there? Let each ministry come up with a plan. I haven't seen that. Maybe because I haven't read the budget speeches. You know, you can't read all the budget speeches.
I just wanted to not respond, but to contribute to what has already been said in answer to what you raised. My position is, and I think it can be testified from books, from theories, from trainings we have, the Tanzanians are like any other human being. And when it comes to administration of the state,
yes,
and other institutions, and the current president has attempted to come back to the way of administering the state and other institutions, there is no midway except genuinely and honestly you must have the rules of the game being played.
Yeah.
Otherwise it doesn't work. And we have experiences with our students, that's why we have sticks and punishment and so forth, and force them to do this and homeworks and so forth. And the state must, it has to. Hakuna njia nyingine. You must have the rules of the games and apply diligently. And so President Magufuli, he will have to see whether what he has been talking about can be effectively and diligently looked at.
Mm.
Otherwise it won't work, because the human being will always want to go underneath and grab whatever he can or she can.
Mm.
That's why there are rules, and that is worldwide, not only in Tanzania. rules of the game must be applied.
Doesn't that require a kind of a strong leader in that case? I mean, who makes decisions? Yeah, if you don't, you
call him strong, call him whatever.
Yes.
But here are the Sharia Zanchi. They must be looked at, and they must be fulfilled. Hakuna mchezo tena, you know.
So I think that's what Prof. Max, what you are saying is literally how the president is trying to set the system operation. I mean, somebody was saying it's like you are doing shock therapy. When a body, even in hospital, if you are sent there already collapsed, they have some machines. Eh? Yeah. They to apply on and boost so that your heart can start beating.
Yeah.
And I think the biggest sort of weakness which we had entered, we had entered a phase of grabiosis. Hmm? Everybody is grabbing whichever is seen on his way, in whatever position. President Kikwete, I remember at one time, in one of the meetings, asking these district councillors, you guys, there's here a report which shows who has stolen the money for the road. Up to now, we have not even taken this person, the culprit, to court. Yes. Then for me, silent, I thought, the president is forgetting that actually this engineer who stole that money, he stole on behalf of those councillors. So how can they take him to court? And I think that's why now, as President Magufuli comes in, if you see the style, the type of boils has been piercing, are related actually to embezzlement, to theft, to mismanagement.
Yeah.
You saw even yesterday's report, the minister for education was saying, even the loans, for the higher education loans, they are hundreds of students, ghost students, receiving loans. You get me? So if you follow the type of boys are related actually to embezzlement, to thefts, and mismanagement of resources. And I think that's why now, because the system, there's a system failure. If you take that case to a policeman, he'll want a share of it. Yeah, so that he can delay or even write a false statement. If you manage to push him to take it to court, the magistrate will want a share of it. And I think as part of the reforms in the judiciary, Chief Justice Chande now gave a timetable that each magistrate now must ensure that you clear X number of cases in a year and there shouldn't be delays. Because one of the tactics in the judiciary they are using, if they know you have given them a bribe and they know they can't rule in your favor because it's obvious that you should be jailed, you keep on postponing the case. For 10 years, the cases are being postponed. So you get me. Now, how do you address that? Because there is the vested interest in the people whom we have trusted to run the institutions. They are protecting, as you are saying, protecting their own interest. There's a conflict now of interest. Now, for that to be rectified, you need that shock therapy, and that's the style which is doing. That's my view, basically, Dina.
Yes, Professor Ngui. We'll move to the next part very soon. That's the budget. But with all what has been said here and what's going on, do you think the country is on the right track?
Mm-hmm. In which front? I would say it depends.
In all of us, because this is with the present administration is focusing on education, as Dino says, is focusing on tax collection, effective tax collection, is focusing on fighting corruption, which was endemic. I suppose it's grand corruption. I don't know whether about small corruption. Accountability, for example, which was NAC. Now, do you think the country is in the right direction in terms of bringing in accountability by the present administration?
Yeah, as we have said, I think in terms of intention, the intentions are good and always really directing to the right direction. But whether we reach there, as it has been said, really it remains to be seen. You could see, for example, from economic point of view, I would say, with all these kind of changes, transformations that are coming, they may send some shockwaves, for example, in the economy. You could see it's good, of course, to fight all the corruptions, good to do all the to make sure that you collect all the taxes, etc., etc. But then there are some elements which may a little bit backfire on the economy. For example, we are seeing a lot of efforts to move towards what we call austerity economics, you know, reducing costs, reducing government expenditure and all this. It's good. It's good. But normally those things have negative unintended consequences. It's good really to reduce government expenditure as much as possible. But then the problem is if we overdo it, yes. And when we overdo it, and then the government is not spending, if the government does not spend really, the economy also may collapse. But also the other thing that we see with all these transformation changes is exactly what we call predictability. There are a lot of things that we are not sure what is going to happen tomorrow in terms of changes that are going to come. Now, this, from an investment point of view, the investors may have what we call a calculate political risk. Now, hedging or insuring against political risk is a big cost. That's why I would say if we see predictability, we are sure what policy is going to come tomorrow, what changes are going to come tomorrow, at least the market will be calm. That's why a year ago, almost on the 3rd of January, I said, after election, even after having new president, there will be wait-and-see stance among the captains and titans of the industry, I would say. And I've said somewhere, and I'll say it here now again, I would propose if people are really genuine, there should be what we call an investment climate survey now. And let captains and titans of the industry explain very frankly what future are they seeing in terms of the investment, the way things are today. I think what we are having are the reports from the World Bank doing a business report before the election. Mm-hmm. We have the World Economic Forum reports before the election. We are having, I think, the business leaders' perception doing business report before the election. Now, after election, mm-hmm. and after seeing what we are seeing now, in order to speak with more authority, with figures,
yes.
There should be such a survey, and that's where we can speak with confidence.
Okay, Professor Ngowi. Now, let's quickly, in the last few minutes remaining, move on to the budget, the 2016-2017, presented by Dr. Mpango, the Minister for Finance, which is 29.5 trillion shillings, although this figure is disputed by some MPs. The budget has been well received, I would say, by Tanzanians, albeit some, of course, with misgivings. Do you think it is a pro-poor budget, and is it pro-really industrialization, as we have heard? I'll come back to you.
Yeah.
Please.
Okay. Yeah. Now, broadly speaking, you can see now this is the 29.5 trillion from last year, which was 22.5. So an increase of 30%. Now, when you look at performance, last year, we managed to attain budget intention in terms of collection 90%. We got 20 trillion instead of 22.5 trillion. Now we want 30 trillion. So how realistic is this, really? With all these things I'm saying, in my view, I think there are some unpredictability in the sector. Now, whether it is proper or not, really, you have to go item by item. But then broadly speaking, I think it's a mixed kind of. And whether it will really deliver industrialization that we want, I doubt, really.
Is it achievable?
What, the budget itself? No, I would say, there are a lot of conditions in order to achieve. Because, you know, I've been doing budget performance review for the past maybe 10, 15 years. We have hardly achieved 100% of our budgets. Looking at the performance of various ministerial budgets until March, April 2016, there are a lot of, money approved by the parliament, but then when it comes to disbursement, only 30%, 60%, 40%, and at times, development revenue, not really going into coffers. So really, I have my reservations on whether we are going to achieve in terms of collecting all that money.
All right. Dina, quickly.
Yeah,
any reaction I'll be
talking from a gender perspective.
Absolutely.
As an activist.
I mean, I would have been surprised if you didn't.
The budget is not gender balanced. We know the situation of women in this country. Women have been pushed to the microeconomics. Women, most of them are doing small businesses, and like making mandazis, vitumbuas, and all this. And this depends, they use sugar. Now sugar has gone up. We are talking about expanding industries. big producers like Barissa and the rest are now going for what women are doing.
Oh, okay.
They are making chapatis, they are making mandazis, so women will be out of the market. Finance institutions, including, there are so many small financiers who are...
Vikobas.
And they are, no, not Vikobas. Mm. There are people who are giving loans to women. And the question is, why are they all going for to women? And you know, they are giving them very little money and they are demanding a lot. So as far as the budget is concerned, women are there to lose. Then we are going to the youth, especially the marching girls. We are talking of, a lot of us are putting on second-hand clothes. And there is also, that has been also interfered with. So we are talking of the common person, but we are not looking at the common person. There's an increase in the telephones. And then when we look at the government structure, now we have a Ministry of Health, women, and I mean, so many people have been lumped into one thing. And the budget for this big Ministry of Health, children, blah, 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 has gone down. It was 11%, now it's 9%. Now you have so many categories of people, a big sector of the society that you're going to save, but the budget is reduced. So definitely the women, when we had our own ministry, we were like clapping.
The Ministry of Women and Gender.
Yeah, that now we have our own ministry. Now that also has been taken away, the budget is low. So where
but
do we go?
It was all done in good faith.
I'm not sure whether
to reduce the government expenditure, reduce the number of ministries.
You remove government expenditure through women expenditure.
No.
Uh-huh. Anyway, that is those are my feelings, okay. That really there will be a discrepancy. It will be very difficult to reach gender parity,
yes,
if we are reducing the budget.
Okay. So, sorry, Dina, because she has talked on the issue which I thought maybe she has forgotten. Actually, provision of water is the second largest after works. So, and I thought actually provision of water to the rural people, even the urban people, the main beneficiary here whose load is reduced will be our mothers and sisters, because they are the ones we normally unfairly give the duty to fetch water.
That is very theoretical. Ututu and draw. We'll see whether
Ututu and draw. That's to my yeah, I think it was your turn.
Very quickly comment.
Well, I have my own perceptions on the whole economic system that is operational in the present times.
Yes.
It's against Tanzania. We can explain that. It's against Tanzania. There was a time when Tanzania was manufacturing, was developing, and so forth.
Yes.
And with investment from foreign countries and so forth and so on, it has all been taken over, including where you have your Bakresa's and
Bakresa,
yes. I mean, I know it from when I was studying the United States. The quality of the stuff was coming from South America, to here. And that's what they've done. And then when you design a program for an economic system that is to benefit the Tanzanians, unfortunately, it doesn't work that way. Never.
So what is your take on that then?
Well, go back to a decision to create an economic system for Tanzania. By Tanzanians and commodities from Tanzania. What is happening now is...
I think maybe that's one of the attempts, Professor Muya, when the five East African countries actually agreed with one voice that it's high time now we revived our textile industry. And as part of that, doing that, we have to gradually reduce the importation of second-hand clothes. So don't you think that's a positive?
Well,
I see that's a positive.
I hope they do.
Provided, of course, we succeed in reviving also interest by farmers to farm cotton, because there's a shortage also of cotton. But overall, I think the way I see this year's budget, it has one pitfall, which I think we have to be carefully dealt with. Because actually 12% of that budget will still depend on donor funding.
Mm-hmm.
and about, is it 15% from borrowing, borrowing from banks, domestic and foreign. What I see, because if you, unless the government has already already agreed on the banks, because the process of borrowing from commercial sources is not a 1 week thing. And if you are talking of financing the budget next year, but we have not yet really sealed the deal on who are going to give us the money from commercial sources, yes. That to me I see one of the weaknesses. But I think, Professor Ngoi, when you talked about the increase of the budget,
yes,
I think Dr. Mpango is banking on the goodwill of mm-hmm. Tanzanians, that now they know that President Magufuli has come with a new sort of style of managing the tax payment system and the tax revenue management, and because now it is even TRA is reporting revenue collection beyond 1 trillion. 1.2, 1.3.
I could comment a little bit on this.
So I know you had the computer that perhaps is after some time that zeal to pay tax compliance might be reduced over time, especially if our industries don't pick up, because that's where most of the tax will have tax revenue will have come from.
So if we,
I think if our MPs, our ministers also keep on encouraging our private sector and encouraging our private sector to invest. Then we're going to get enough revenue for financing that budget. And of course, if we continue to sustain that the style of in terms of taking care of our tax revenue, sealing all the loopholes for leakage.
Yes.
If we manage to, and I'm surprised the way there are too many leakages which I never knew. Frankly, innocently, some of the things never been reported, because our auditors are the ones who should tell us this is what is happening. How can you know that when students, for example, are complaining that they are not getting enough money mm-hmm. on time, and yet there are some who did not know of all the institutions that help will be actually allowing payment to cost students?
Yeah.
You get me? So there are a lot of surprises coming out every day, which somehow gives us hope that if we manage to seal all the loopholes, the revenue we collect is properly used, and instead of directing that money to recurrent expenditure, we direct it to development expenditure, and that development expenditure has a larger component of domestic resources, because one of the weaknesses of our development expenditure projects that most of the things are imported also, because our factories also don't produce. So if I think that's
well, maybe
so
that's
that
why
money is lost without creating
that's
jobs.
That's why Magufuli's government is aiming at making this country an industrial based
yes, exactly.
country.
It's questionable as well.
Is it?
Yeah, because I get surprised. For example, unga wa bakresa. Whatever your Bakresa, cake is a Bakresa. That damn thing is coming from Latin America
for free, the flour.
To the bank, the flour, to the harbors here in Dar es Salaam, and we know it. I know it, to Dar es Salaam, and the harbor doesn't charge anything. It must go. It was only after the discussions, private right. discussions. So
well, that
it's
that
factual.
Was that was the time that was
it is
because.
Factual.
I mean, many of us were surprised, including viewers, were also surprised that there were so many fake employees
exactly.
in the in a series, in a number of workplaces. I mean, people drawing money out of fake stuff, so some of them are dead, some of them are not there. So there were so many loopholes, as we said, many holes where the resources were being siphoned out and the government was left without any resources. So that's a plus for Magufuli, at least, to try and discover these loopholes so that we have enough resources. Then they are directed to the right place where they are needed.
Discover?
Well,
I don't know.
It's part of the system.
Exactly.
It's like red money and crap coming and said we discovered the
exactly. They were David, there. David Livingstone and Morton Stanley discovering Ujiji, Kigoma. All right. Yeah. Well, we have only 5 minutes, gentlemen. Very quickly, then. I start with the professor. What is your final word on this, the discussion?
I think it's a good starting point that we discuss it open outside the framework of the government, which knows this, yes. And we know it, we study it, we do have the data.
All right, very quickly.
Very quickly, I would say we are on the right track, but there needs to be a systematic way of monitoring, a systematic way of accountability. But we have to have priorities and time frames because there is so much which needs to be done.
Excellent.
In my view, the legacy of this government will be remembered, will be built by actually strengthening three key institutions.
Yes, very quickly.
The judiciary, the police force, and institutions overlooking good governance in the country.
Okay.
But on the other side, we need also the support of our legislators, members of parliament, to make sure that this new phenomena where Tanzanians are responding positively,
yes,
to be responsible taxpayers,
yes,
led by our MPs,
yes,
if they should agree also to pay taxes,
yes, to pay taxes
so that we,
yes,
all pay taxes,
yes,
that if we can succeed also to make sure that we follow up in terms of expenditure, the allocations, that,
yes,
they're properly used, then we are going somewhere.
All right. Mm. Very quickly.
Yeah, yeah. I would say for the this first administration to work well, really it should not be really a one-man show. It should not be a micromanaging kind of a thing. All those who are around the president,
yes,
should support him. And should support him because if they believe that what he's doing is correct, not because they fear him.
All right. Well, thank you very much, my panelists, for your contribution and a very serious analysis of the situation that we find ourselves in with this fifth phase administration. Viewers, as we've heard from my panelists here, the fifth phase administration under John Pombe Magufuli has certainly brought some interesting dynamism in the country, political and public service leadership, environment, and way of doing things. The business as usual attitude, as we've heard from my panelists here, seems to be no longer the issue, other than commitment to delivering service to the people. There will be those, of course, who would say it is too early to judge and even conclude that President Magufuli's administration has achieved much in 7 months. Serious reservations in some quarters, notwithstanding. The discussion in this first program, after 2 years' absence from the airs, has indicated positive developments and an acknowledgement that there is a sense of accountability being rebuilt in the country, and that President Magufuli's first budget for 2016-2017 has been presented to Parliament by Dr. Mpango, Minister for Finance. Despite divergent opinions and views on the budget, as we also have seen here, generally the budget has been well received as propoor, although Dr. Dina says no. And industrial growth, this is what they're saying, whether it will be achieved or not, as we heard from Professor Muya here, says it's doubtful. Except, of course, on the new taxes. I mean, we didn't talk much about the taxes, like the taxes on tourism. Will it help or hinder development of the tourism, which is a bigger resource earner, a big
foreign exchange
earner. However, let us all give him, that's President Magufuli, the support he needs to achieve the intended goals to bring not only change, but effective development to this country. That's all we have for you tonight. Until next Sunday at the same time, 21 hours, that is 9 o'clock, and on Thursday at 15 hours in the afternoon for the repeat program. On behalf of my panel, Dr. Dina Mbaga, Professor Maxim Moya, Professor Ngowi, and Dr. Negero, and my TBC television crew, thank you, viewers, and goodbye.